One of the successes that came up was when you started looking at the atmosphere of an exoplanet, if I have this right, of GJ1214b.
And right, it really like rolls off the tongue, right?
It does. You got to.
You should.
Work with these
you really
guys.
Should know this planet.
tell me about this. It's bigger than Earth, but smaller than Neptune. Is that right?
That's right. So it sounds like it's sort of this in-between size planet that maybe is not very interesting. But it turns out it's a class of planets. It's a representative of a class of planets that's the most common kind of planet in our galaxy. 50% of stars like the sun in our galaxy have a planet like this that does not exist in our solar system.
Huh.
And so the discovery of these objects, which happened around 2010, was a shock. The theorists who calculate models for planet formation did not predict their existence. And when they showed up, it's like, who ordered this? Huh. We didn't want this. Like, why this? And then it became like, gosh, they're so common. And they're really enigmatic because we don't have a template in the solar system. Since they're between the Earth and Neptune, you could imagine, well, maybe it's a smaller Neptune or a bigger Earth, right? And we've really been struggling to understand these objects and use pieces of information from a lot of different types of exoplanet research to try to piece together a story of what these objects are and how they form.
Okay. If we talk about other discoveries that came out, and I'm probably not pronouncing this right, but one of the others that stood out was, is it Gliese 486b?
Come on, that's another one that should just roll off the tongue. Gliese 486b. Everyone knows that, right?
Everybody, they will now.
Right, so that's a rocky extrasolar planet that I actually helped discover.
Okay.
And it's become a key target for the James Webb Space Telescope because it's a terrestrial planet orbiting a very nearby star. It's very favorable for atmospheric characterization. And we've been trying to answer this question about whether it has an atmosphere or not.
Okay. Now, if that means that you think there's water vapor on this, is that correct?
Right. So there were some first observations with the James Webb Space Telescope indicated that this planet did have an atmosphere and it had water vapor in its atmosphere. So that'd be really exciting. That's exactly what we're looking for. But there was speculation that the signal that JWST was measuring for this planet was not from the planet itself. It was actually contamination of the signal from the star. Stars, unfortunately, are variable. And the measurement technique that we use to probe these planets' atmospheres depends on a certain level of stability in time. And so if the star is variable, that can contaminate the measurements. And you have to try to disentangle what the star might be doing from what the planet's doing. And that can be tricky.
Okay.
My team has done some observations, though, using a technique that's much less sensitive to stellar variability. And our observations suggest, unfortunately, this planet is a bare rock, that it doesn't have any atmosphere at all.
Okay.
Now,
is this the one where you look at the heat on the planet? Well, I don't know.
That's right. So we developed a technique about, 5-6 years ago before the James Webb Space Telescope launched. We asked ourselves, what would be the simplest most robust way, right? The technique that would be less susceptible to being fooled for seeing if a planet doesn't have an atmosphere. Because the first rocky planets that we're going to look at with JWST, to be honest, we picked the easiest ones. And the easiest ones are less likely to have an atmosphere. Let's start there because it takes less telescope time to do those and then work our way towards cooler objects, less irradiated objects that may have atmosphere. So if your expectation is the planet doesn't have an atmosphere, the best way to figure that out, to confirm that hypothesis, is actually look at the temperature on the day side of the planet.
Okay.
If you measure that, you can do an energy balance calculation that says, what's the maximum possible temperature? And then what's the cooler temperature that you would get if the planet has an atmosphere that's reflecting some starlight back out into space and absorbing some of that starlight and distributing it evenly over the planet? So if you go measure the temperature of a rocky planet and it has its maximum possible dayside temperature, the feeling is that there's no atmosphere. So that's what we did for this planet. Is that we measured the temperature, we got about 700 Kelvin. That's as hot as the planet could be, which means the planet is a bare rock. It's not got an atmosphere reflecting starlight. It's not transporting heat. It's just absorbing all the incident starlight and then re-emitting it back towards us. And that's the infrared light that we see from the planet. We deduce its temperature and it's very hot. So unfortunately, this planet doesn't have an atmosphere.
Okay. And when you find a planet and it doesn't have atmosphere, are you let down and you say, let's go find the next one? Or how do you think about that?
Well, so first of all, it informs just our general understanding of how planets form and retain atmospheres. And this retaining the atmosphere is a really key element here, because we take for granted that terrestrial planets can have atmospheres. We're existing here on the Earth. We have a beautiful atmosphere. Our next door neighbor, Venus, also has an atmosphere. But if you look farther afield, right, Mars has a very thin atmosphere. Mercury has no atmosphere at all. And the moon, which is the same distance from the Earth, from the sun as the Earth is, also has no atmosphere. So terrestrial bodies can and can't have atmospheres. And we want to understand what sets that dichotomy between the haves and the have-nots. And the theory that we have is this idea called the cosmic shoreline, which relates how much energy the star puts out that's incident on the object, on the planet, versus its gravity, which is its ability to hold on to an atmosphere. So you got this competition between ability to blast off an atmosphere from high radiation from the star or high gravity, the ability to hold on to an atmosphere. And so that sets up this dichotomy. That's our working hypothesis about what separates the haves and have-nots in the solar system. We want to see if that applies to extrasolar planets. So on one hand, it's disappointing because if the planet Gliese 46b that we looked at had an atmosphere, that would have made all this so much easier, right? We'd be like, oh, great, we're going to start looking for life like today, right? Because there it is, right? It could be there. But our expectation under this cosmic shoreline hypothesis was that it didn't have an atmosphere. Based on what we knew about its properties and what its star is, we didn't actually expect that. And so it fits this hypothesis. So it's not upsetting from that standpoint. And then it guides us to what we should do next. We should push on to planets that would be on the other side of the shoreline. And there's where we would expect them. But that will be harder, right? So the reason we did this planet first was it was easy. We did just one little JWST observation with a few hours of telescope time, and we could say, no atmosphere, move on.
I was going to ask you about another planet, but I know I'm going to get mocked. So before I do, I want to ask you, how in the world do you guys come up with these names? Because I'm going to ask you about K218b. And so let's start with how in the world do these planets get their names?
So in a way, it's very simple. So the stars typically have a name. And that's it's usually a combination of two components. One is the catalog of stars that it's in, and the other is just a number. It's just a line in a table, right? So for example, to go back to GJ1214, that's a catalog named after two German guys who made a catalog of nearby stars almost 100 years ago now.
Okay.
GJ are their initials, and then 1214 is just where it was in this list. And so it's just as random as a telephone number, right? Why do you have the telephone number you have? It's just random chance. There's some system, but you don't know what it is. So it's really unimaginative. But as you can tell,
it's orderly.
It's orderly. And those of us who study them, we know these phone numbers to these planets as well as you would know your mom's phone number, for example, right? Or your home phone number when you're a kid, or your best friend's phone number. Right.
So those, tell me what was so impressive. Yeah. Tell me what was so impressive about K218b then.
So K218b is an interesting planet. It's bigger than the Earth. It's one of these intermediate sized planets between the Earth and Neptune. And its amount of irradiation it gets from its host star, depending on what its whole structure is, what its atmosphere is, what its interior is, it could have liquid water below a deep atmosphere. And as I said, liquid water is that precondition for life. And so anywhere in our solar system or in the broader universe where we could find liquid water, that automatically becomes an interesting place for astrobiology. The thing about K218 were some chemical species were detected in the atmosphere that were somewhat indicative that there was this liquid water ocean below the atmosphere.
An ocean,
liquid water, right?
Okay.
And so it was somewhat indicative of that. So there's two things to remember about this, though. One is not everyone agreed that the detection of these certain molecules that were seen actually indicated an ocean. There were chemical pathways for creating those molecules that didn't involve liquid water at all. So not everyone agreed on that. The other thing is these measurements were sort of down near the level of the noise. And not everyone agrees that all of these molecules that were initially claimed are actually present there. So that's okay, right? Nobody should be discouraged or think, oh gosh, these astronomers don't know what they're doing. This is a normal part of the scientific process just unfolding, right? So we found this planet, we started studying it, we saw something interesting, let's keep studying it. We'll get more data, and those data have already been obtained. I'm sure people are analyzing them. We'll increase the signal to noise, our sensitivity of our measurements. We'll see if those molecules are there. At the same time, we're developing more sophisticated models that will tell us whether which molecules that we see in the atmosphere are indicative of a surface or a subsurface, sub-atmosphere liquid water ocean or not, right? And so what's really exciting is this is all just unfolding. And the general public, honestly, can follow it in near real time, right? Mm-hmm. This is not science in a textbook that somebody discovered 100 years ago, and you read it and you take it as fact, right? This is the scientific process unfolding before our eyes with an amazing telescope that our engineers built and our government, you know, with its decades of foresight, decided to fund, right? And so we're the whole world is part of this story that's playing out here. And we're having the fun, right, of seeing, like, does this planet have a liquid water ocean? Could we imagine life existing there? If life is existing, what sort of more subtle molecules is it putting in the atmosphere that we could detect, right? And so I think it's just a fantastic story, but there's a lot of controversy. Like any interesting scientific discovery, there's going to be controversy. And so that's just playing out right now. And I think it's a really fun thing to watch.